Welcome to Vodcast 4.2.1, where we will be filling in your diagram notes, pages 3 through 9, covering continental drift and seafloor spreading.
Land seems like it's barely moving. Pidgey was the idea Wagner believed in.
We already know about the Earth's layers. Now we're going to focus on the upper layer, the crust. This guy over here is Alfred Wegener, and he proposed the theory that the continents once fit together and have drifted apart. And this was in the early 1900s. He said that they all fit together in one large super landmass called Pangaea. And he had several pieces of evidence to show that the continents might have fit together. Number one, the first piece of evidence is what's called the jigsaw puzzle fit. And he looked at how the shapes of the continents would fit together, and they almost fit together like pieces in a jigsaw. Some of the best fit would be South America and Africa fitting together, North America fitting into Africa as well. Second piece of evidence besides the jigsaw puzzle fit were fossil clues. He found evidence of fossils of the Mesosaurus, which is a freshwater reptile, and that's important, in both Africa and South America. Presently, they're separated by the Atlantic Ocean, which is seawater, saltwater. This is a freshwater reptile which could not survive or swim across that ocean. So the theory is, or the question was, how did it get into two different continents that are separated by 1,000 miles? Next piece of evidence is the Glossopteris, which is a fern plant-like species, and it's found in Africa, India, Australia, Antarctica, and South America. And they're separated again by thousands of miles. The seedlings could not blow across the ocean. So how did they get into such a diverse area and all those different continents? Possibly if they were connected together. Next are rock clues. The Appalachian Mountains, which run up the east coast of the United States, match mountains in Greenland and Europe with rocks that are the same age and the same composition, meaning they're made up of the same minerals. Another piece of evidence is the age and the mineral content of rocks were similar also in South America and Africa. They matched up, same age, made of the same stuff. Fourth piece of evidence is what we call climate clues. Coal, which we know forms from vegetation, tropical-like vegetation as it breaks down, decomposes, gets compressed into rock. That's found in North America, Antarctica. North America, we know states as West Virginia, Pennsylvania are major coal mining states. However, they're way too warm to have that kind of vegetation in them. But possibly North America may have been somewhere else. And when he pieced it back together in Pangaea, it had North America, Florida down by the equator, and New York and Pennsylvania down in the tropics, which could support that type of plants. And finally, scratches in the rocks. Glacial scratches or scarring in rocks of South America, South Africa, even India a little bit. These all show evidence of scratches on the rocks as glaciers moved over them, and the pieces of rock that were stuck to the bottom of a glacier, as they moved across the land, they would actually scratch the rock, almost like sandpaper. As you can see in this animation, as the glacier moves, it's picking up rocks on the bottom, which are scratching the land that they move over. So if we take a look at all this evidence and we go back to this map, which shows where he believed Pangaea was according to the jigsaw fit, we will see that right here, when we overlay it with his evidence, we can see some of the examples. All the shading and coding in here represents what we saw in the outline below. For example, the Mesosaurus is the open circle. So you can see the Mesosaurus here and here, as well as the rock types that match up. The Appalachian Mountains that match up, the glacial scarring of Antarctica, Australia, India, Africa, South America, some places that today are way too warm to have glaciers, and also the coal deposits in North America. On the next page here, what we're going to see is just an outline of the different features under the ocean floor. We have a continental shelf, followed by the continental slope, or it drops down deep, and then a trench, which is that V-shaped valley. The bottom of the seafloor is called the abyssal plain. So if you think of the ocean floor almost as an in-ground swimming pool, the continental shelf would be like the shallow end, the abyssal plain would be the bottom of the deep end, And the continental slope would be that slope that transitions from the shallow end down to the deep end. Okay, so we also have the trench that's shown there. You'll take a look at this area. That's a guy out, which is a flat top seamount. It got flattened on top because it was once at sea level, which wore it away. Mid-ocean ridges in the middle, where the plates are going to move away from each other, with a rift valley in the center. That's the crack where they separate from. And finally, a seamount, which is simply an underwater mountain. Now, Wegener came up with the jigsaw puzzle fit and all of his evidence, but he failed to explain what caused the continents to move. And because of that, his theory was not accepted. It wasn't until the 1940s that we used sonar, we got a mapping of the ocean floor, and we started to go sample the ocean floor, that we started to get some more evidence to help prove what he said. The first piece of evidence is seafloor spreading. Here, what we see is this is a mid-ocean ridge in the middle, and as the youngest rock is at the mid-ocean ridge, where it's rising up and cooling and turning into rock, the magma is rising up, and as we move away from it, it gets older and older and older. So we'll see that the age of the ocean floor gets older on either side as we move out from the mid-ocean ridge. What this started to show is that maybe the ocean floor is actually separating and pulling apart, and new rock is forming in the middle, which would make it younger rock. Second piece of evidence to support that is called paleomagnetism, which is magnetic evidence in the rock that shows that the ocean floor may be separating. What we're seeing here in the diagram is the dark shaded area would be normal polarity, and you'll see that today there's normal polarity where the mid-ocean ridge is, and the white area is reverse polarity, which simply means that if you had a compass needle, the North Pole would be down by Antarctica. So what this shows us is that we have a mirror image on each side of the mid-ocean ridge. It matches in thickness and it matches in polarity, where north is at the same spot, and then if you go out a little bit more, they're both showing a reverse polarity. And then if you go further out, both sides again show a north polarity. And this shows that the ocean floor is not only separating, but when these rocks cooled and hardened, the pieces of iron in them, which lined up north and south, those gave us the clue to which way magnetic north was. And we'll see that magnetic north has flipped over time, and it matches on each side, which helps us to believe that when these rocks formed, each of those sides was at the mid-ocean ridge forming and has since moved away. Okay, so with his theory of seafloor spreading, it states that the lithosphere, which is the upper crust in the mantle, is divided into sections called tectonic plates. And to help Wegener along, his continents sat on these tectonic plates, so as the plates moved, the continents moved with them. In this part here, numbers 1 through 8, I want you to label the 8 major tectonic plates, and you can use page 5 of your reference tables to find the names of those plates. So if you hit pause, you can do that now. And we'll come back. Hopefully you have numbers 1 through 8 filled in. Plate motion. The theory of plate tectonics states that these lithospheric plates are in motion and float or ride on the asthenosphere. So number 2 here is asthenosphere. Direction of plate movement. The movement and interaction of tectonic plates creates 3 types of boundaries, and we'll take a look at these 3 boundaries here. The first boundary is a divergent boundary, and their movement, they are going to move away from each other, and on the arrows on our map would show that the 2 plates are moving in opposite directions. Second type of boundary is a convergent boundary, where they move towards each other. The arrows there, it would look like one going one way and obviously the other one coming towards it. Finally, a transform boundary. In a transform boundary, they are moving laterally or sideways alongside each other, which we kind of draw like this. So there's a quick overview to fill in your notes on continental drift, the evidence for continental drift, and seafloor spreading.